there is a Windows feature that most people have never heard of before, but is extremely useful. It's basically a way to create, you can sort of think of it like super shortcuts to files and folders. But what exactly does that mean and why is it so useful? That's what I'm going to explain and then show you how to make some yourself. The general term for what I'm talking about are symbolic links or symlinks, and they're not exclusive to Windows, they are on other operating systems, and there's a couple different names that we'll be getting into, but the general term is symbolic links. And looking at them in Windows Explorer, it kind of looks the same with the same icon as a regular shortcut. However, there are subtle but big differences. If you, for example, create a shortcut in Windows Explorer and then click it to go to a new directory, you are basically in that new directory. The path changed. It's kind of like teleporting, you can think of. You teleported to the other location on the hard drive. With a symlink to a directory, though, you still go to that new directory and you still see all the files just like as if you went to that other directory the normal way. But notice the file path this time. The upper levels of that file path are actually the same. They didn't change like it did with a shortcut. And if you navigate into further directories, it still stays the same. So even though you are actually accessing directories and files that are technically in another location, any software that goes through the symlink will just see it as being part of the original path, and it's not like a shortcut that moved you. So it's sort of thinking like, whereas a shortcut is a teleporter, a symlink is kind of like a portal. So in other words, what I mean by that is when you click a shortcut, you're teleported, it's kind of like a one-off thing, you move directories, and now anything you do over there stays over there, whatever. Whereas if you access it through a symlink, the portal sort of stays open while you're going in and doing whatever, so anytime you modify the directories or files within that symlink, you're actually modifying the real files that are located somewhere else, but the software sees it as happening at this symlink directory, which is not the technical actual place it is, but it still affects the other location. Symlinks can also be used for individual files, not just a whole directory. So with a shortcut, if you create a shortcut to a file, it'll open up that file. Whereas with a symlink, it'll still open up that file, but it'll look like that file is in the symlink directory and not the real place it is. So the program thinks it's, again, somewhere it's not. However, some smarter programs like Notepad++ might recognize it as a symlink and actually open and show the path of the real file. Now, you might be wondering, all right, it doesn't seem like that big of a difference. Why is this such a big deal? And let me give you some example use cases. Say you're installing a program and it doesn't let you choose where you want to install those files, but it's a big program or something and you want to move it to a secondary drive, not your main drive, but you can't choose where to install it. So what you could do is install the program and then move the files to whatever drive you want, whatever location you want, and then create a symlink from the original location to the new one, and then the program will just be happy to run the files through the symlink. It doesn't know that they're on the other drive. It sees it as being the same exact directory location as before. One really common use is for cloud storage services like Dropbox or OneDrive, where they usually give you one folder to put all the stuff you want to be backed up and synced into, but say you want to back up and sync files that are located elsewhere on your computer, and you don't want to just put it all into this one folder. You want to keep the locations you have. What you could do is create a symlink in the Dropbox or OneDrive folder that goes to whatever files you want that are located anywhere, and Dropbox or OneDrive will now think that those files are in that folder and just kind of sync them to the cloud. So effectively, you can sync whatever you want, not just what's in the one folder. Now, a third use case is one that I actually had to use recently, and it kind of inspired this video, which is say you move a directory with a whole bunch of files you were using for other stuff and you move it to another drive, in my case, my Dropbox folder, but a bunch of programs were using those files and they were referenced to that location, and now they're gonna think those files are all missing. You would have to go in and individually tell the program where these new files are. And while I did update the references in the programs when I could, I figured there would be some that I forgot about and I didn't really wanna break anything, so I simply created a symlink for the Dropbox folder from the old location into the new one, and then any programs that are now looking for those files will not even know that the Dropbox moved at all. And of course, everything is still located through the actual path, so it's not like you have to use the symlink path from now on, it's like you can use both. Now, there are some other major differences between regular shortcuts that you're familiar with and symlinks, so let me talk about those to make things a little bit more clear. First of all, a shortcut in Windows is actually a file in itself. and it actually has its own file extension, .lnk or .link. This file extension will not normally show even if you enable showing file extensions for other file types. The only way to get it to show is to go into the registry. There is a registry tweak, and then it'll make Windows show it. And also to drive this home, because it is a file, it has a size even though it's kind of small. So Windows shortcuts are pretty much just made to be used with Windows Explorer, and they might not necessarily be supported by other third-party programs unless the developer added that support in. Just like any other file type, if the program doesn't support that file type, then it won't work. For example, you can see this program, devc++, tries to open it and just the raw data shows up. So if you move a file and then create a shortcut to the new location and rename the shortcut to the same file type as before, thinking that, oh, now the program will see the shortcut, try to access it, and then move to the new location, no, that doesn't work. It's going to see the .link extension, say, this isn't the file I'm looking for, where's the file, and then just mark it as missing. Symbolic links, though, are actual features built directly into the file system, so it's not like there's any .link extension. The program will just access the symlink, and it won't even know that it's a symlink. It just gets automatically resolved to its new location, and for what it knows, it's still accessing the same path as before. It doesn't know that it's in some other path on some other drive or whatever. Another difference is you usually can't execute a command on a shortcut. So if you use CMD or something and try to do something with a shortcut, it's not going to know to redirect the command to the thing it's pointing to. If you do it with a symlink, though, the command actually will be redirected to act on the path of the actual location of that file, and it will work fine. Before showing you how to create these different symlinks, there are a couple terms you'll see that I need to explain. You don't have to remember the details here, just know that they exist, basically. So again, symbolic links are a general term. They're not exclusive to Windows. They've actually been around for ages, since like the 70s at least, so they're not new. However, in Windows, there are three types of symbolic links. Now, the first type is simply called symbolic link. That's the only slightly confusing thing. So of the symbolic links types, one of them is just called symbolic link, and this does all the same stuff that we just talked about. It can redirect to files and folders, and it's actually the newest of the three types, and it's also probably the most versatile. So this is the one most people are going to use. However, there are two other older types, which are basically just kind of kept around as a legacy thing for compatibility. One of them is called a junction, aka a soft link, which is basically just going to work for directories. And then the other one is a hard link, which only works on files. But again, for the most part, the symbolic link feature can do the job of both of these, so that's the one that most people are going to be using. Now, there are some minor differences, so I at least want to mention what those are, because technically, the older legacy ones might still be useful in some certain limited circumstances, which you'll see. So with a hard link, again, this can only be used for individual files, not directories. And another limitation is hard links can only be used to redirect to files on the same volume of a drive, so the same drive letter, basically. So it can't go to another drive or another partition or anything else. Whereas a symbolic link can go to any path, even a remote directory on another computer, like a mapped network drive or something. So that's a big win for symbolic links. However, there is an advantage to hard links, which symbolic links cannot do, which is if you move the target file, the hard link will actually get updated automatically. So for example, you can see here, I have this text file in this test slash folder A, and it contains the text Big Chungus. And I've created a hard link to this file in the root directory of the drive. And notice how it can be a different name. It doesn't have to be the same exact thing. And you'll notice with a hard link, it looks like the actual file. There's no shortcut symbol or anything. And that is one notable unique thing about hard links, is that a hard link to an individual file is basically indistinguishable from an actual file. If you like go to properties, it's just gonna look like an actual file. You don't know that it's a hard link necessarily. And even if you use the directory command in the command prompt, it will recognize symlinks and junctions, but not hard links. So if you create a hard link, just make sure you don't forget which one is which and delete the wrong one by accident. Anyway, you can see that if I move the target file to folder B, the link actually still works. It gets updated. So just to make sure that's actually what's happening, let's change the text in the file to say Big Chungus ABC. And when we go and check the link again, yep, it still goes to that updated text file. So it obviously updated the link. It's in a new location now. So a hard link could be better if you're going to be dealing with files that are going to be moved around and updated, but still will stay on the same exact volume. All right, now let's do junctions. And again, this is a type of symbolic link that only works on a directory. A limitation of junctions is the target directory must be on the same computer. It can be on a different volume and drive. Unlike a hard link, it just has to be on the same computer. So for example, it can't be on a mapped network drive or a remote location. Whereas again, symbolic links can be anywhere, even on a remote location. And also junctions can't do relative paths. They have to be an absolute path, whereas symbolic links can. So not really many advantages to junction, except maybe for security purposes, you don't want to create a junction that might go to another network drive or something, but for the most part, there's not really any advantage to using one. All right, so now you know how everything works, let's get into how to actually make some of these symbolic links. So what you'll do is open up the command prompt, and we're gonna use the command mklink, which is short for make link. And if you don't type anything else and just hit enter here, it'll show you all the parameters for this command and basically how it works. The H and J parameters there are for hard links and junctions, and we're just going to ignore those, but it's basically the same exact process, and I already showed you how they work. Really, the only optional parameter here is /D, which you need to put if it's going to be a symbolic link for a directory. Otherwise, just the default is going to be for a file. So say I want to make a link to the test folder on my C drive. So that's the target and it's coming from the D drive. So first you do make link /D. Then you need to put the path for where the link will exist. So the from location. So let's call it D:\example-link-test. That's gonna be the fake link directory. And again, it doesn't need to match the target. You just make whatever you want. And then you put a space and the target directory, which is where we're going to, and it's just gonna be C:\test. Now it will say that the link was created and show little arrows with the different paths. So we can test it. If we go into the D drive and then go into the symbolic link, it now looks like the files are in the same D:\example-link-test path directory, but they're not. We know that they're actually in the C:\test, and we can still access it from that real directory, but now also through the symbolic link. And also, it doesn't take up any space on the D drive where the symbolic link is. It only takes up space on the real location. Now, if you want to delete a symbolic link, you can delete it just like a shortcut, and it won't affect the directory that it's pointing to. However, remember that if you go into the symbolic link and you're looking at the files that are in the other location, modifying them and deleting the files that are in that other location will actually delete them. So you can delete the entire symlink because it's just the link, but if you go in and delete anything and modify anything, you're actually modifying that stuff. All right, now let's do a file example. It's pretty much the same process. So let's just target a specific text file in another folder called hello.txt. So first, let's decide where the link will be from, and let's do D:\hello-link-example.txt. It can be named anything, but just make sure you use the same file extension so it's gonna open up in this right program. Then we can get the path of the file to target, and by the way, one easy way to do this is shift right-click on the file and hit copy as path. That copies the path to the clipboard, whether it's a file or folder, it works on both, and then you can just paste it into the command. And remember, since it's a file, we don't need any other parameters. File is default, so we can just hit enter and it'll say symbolic link created again. And now this file opens up and edits just like it would the original. And unlike a hard link, it actually does show the shortcut symbol. But if you do right click it, you will notice it says the type of file is a symlink text file, not a shortcut. Oh, and one side thing, if you're wondering what happens if you delete the .link extension off of a shortcut, I was wondering the same thing. And it seems to depend on the program. For this shortcut to a text file, I opened it with Notepad++, and it still recognized it as a shortcut and opened the target text file. But regular Notepad literally just opened up the raw data of the shortcut. But anyway, with all this knowledge, you're now ready to go and use this incredibly useful feature, or maybe not right now, but you'll come across someday where you're like, ah, I remember that, and you can take advantage of it. If you found this video useful, be sure to give it a thumbs up and let me know down in the comments if you knew about this before or not. And if you guys want to subscribe, be sure to also click the bell next to the subscribe button. I make videos about twice a week, not too often, so you don't want to have them get lost in the rest of your subscription feed. Now, if you guys want to keep watching, the next video I'd recommend is why sometimes you plug in a USB drive, but it doesn't show up in Windows. Why is that? I explain how to fix it in a few different ways. So you can click on that right there to watch it. So thanks for watching, guys, and I'll see you in the next one.